Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're really excited to have you here. Just want to give you some background. So I'm going to be your moderator for this conversation, for today's session, focused on transitions into adulthood, employment and higher education. To start off, I want to thank our visionary technology sponsor, Drs. Bonnie and Jonathan Rothberg and family. And I want to welcome everyone who's joining us via the live stream as well. After each session, we ask you to please fill out a brief session survey. And as you all know at this point, if you complete that survey, you'll be entered into a daily drawing for a prize. So I would definitely take advantage of that. As you can see here, we have some info just related to password and Wi-Fi. So just to kick us off, we're going to do some brief introductions. So just to tell you a little bit about myself, I am an adult living with TSC. I'm 27 years old, born and raised in New York City, and I currently work in healthcare marketing strategy. When I was in undergrad, I studied industrial and labor relations. I was very focused in public policy. As you could see on the screen, I did have a stint as an amateur curler, so I caught the Olympic fever a little bit and gave it my best shot. I highly recommend it if you're ever in a cold area. It's a fun sport to do, especially with a team. I am definitely an animal lover, and I follow many French Bulldog Instagram accounts, so if anyone here has a French Bulldog, please talk to me after. It's not a joke. Okay. Very, very passionate about the work that we do in this community, particularly as it relates to advocacy at the policy level, and also strongly committed to diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts. I currently also serve on the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Task Force. I see Laura here. It's an incredible group of people. And definitely, just it's been such a privilege being here, these past few days with all of you, and really looking forward to introducing my fellow panelists here, who have done some really incredible work and are just great, great people. So, with that, I will pass it over to Celie to introduce herself.
Mentioned. My name's Celie Johnson. I was born and raised in Birmingham, Alabama, but I've lived in Boston for the past 6 years. I came up for school. I graduated from Boston University in 2020 with a degree in psychology and human development, focus on child health. I was a future leader in 2021, and I will be starting nursing school at the MGH Institute of Health Professions in January. A little bit of fun fact, I grew up on a farm for the first 6 years of my life. Yes, I did have a pet chicken. And I love sports, especially football. I will say that my favorite is Alabama Crimson Tide, so just putting that out there. And I look forward to just sharing more about my journey through higher education, the resources that I specifically sought out, and learning what worked for me, and how that can be beneficial to other people. And with that, I will kick it away to Kirk.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. My name is Kirk McCreary. I am a 24-year-old adult with TSC. A little bit about me. I was born and raised in Los Angeles, California, although I do currently reside in the greater Denver, Colorado region. Professionally, I currently work as a high school teacher in Colorado. The classes I teach orient in career development and readiness and marketing, and I also work as a baseball coach at the high school I work at as well. After high school, I decided that college was the route that I wanted to take based off of what I wanted to do professionally. So I studied both international business and German in college. A little fun fact, I did live in Europe for about a year, splitting time between Germany and the United Kingdom. I'm currently pursuing my master's in education at the University of Colorado at Colorado Springs. And just a few fun facts about me. I'm really into baseball. I love comedy. I love going outside and hiking, taking advantage of all the beautiful nature that exists in this world. I'm into music production. I happen to have a Spotify account. I do that for fun on the side. I love to read, and then anything with a board, so skateboarding, surfing, snowboarding, and I love to travel as well. So it's a little bit about me.
Hello, I'm Preston Fitzgerald. I'm from the Dallas-Fort Worth area. I currently work in the hotel industry after I just graduated college from University of North Texas, and currently looking for a job in the hotel industry, so if anybody knows, please let me know. I'm also a world traveler. I've traveled to 21 different countries and 29 states, and I'm a big sports fan, so anything from the Cowboys to the Mavericks I love, and very artistic, and also a big fan of the weather. And yes, it does always get this hot here in Texas. And I will pass it on to Emily.
All right, so I'm Emily Racenet. I'm born and raised in Wasilla, Alaska. So it was a bit of a trip here. I am a sibling of someone with TSC. My younger sister has TSC. She was diagnosed very young. I don't remember how, I don't remember it. That's how long ago it was. I am a student at Alaska Pacific University, which is a very outdoorsy school. I'm minoring in outdoor studies with a major in marine and environmental sciences. As you can see, I kind of do a lot of dog stuff. She does have an Instagram, but she isn't a Frenchie. I'm sorry, Jonathan. So that's kind of my life. I do everything I can outside. I do dock diving. That's my aunt's boat there. The golden retriever there is Zinger. That was Caitlin's old service dog. She passed away about a year ago now. But yeah, we would go out hiking constantly. There was whitewater rafting a little while ago too. Yeah, if you guys want to come up to Alaska, I'll be a tour guide. That's all I'm saying.
All right, well, thank you all so much for those introductions, and I do, in fact, follow your dog on Instagram, so I do move beyond Frenchies. Okay, so with that, I want to now move us into the actual presentation portion of this session, and I'm really excited to introduce Deanna and, let her dive into, some of the legal aspects of what we hope to share with you. So, Deanna, I'll kick it over to you.
Thank you, Jonathan. Good morning, everybody. It's so nice to be here. I appreciate and thank everybody for inviting me to speak today. I am a partner at Russo Law Group, which is a law firm in New York on Long Island. I was born and raised there. I have been an estate planning, special needs planning, Medicaid attorney for over 20 years. And I have a great passion for this. I spent most of my schooling and both undergrad and law school working in a nursing home, and I have family members who have epilepsy, and so I can bring to the table of this type of planning a little bit more compassion and understanding for some of what people are going through, and a conference like this gives me an opportunity to hear a little bit more about things that are going on in the world, especially in this area. And when I meet with clients who have these kinds of issues, I have a little bit more understanding than your average attorney, and I can be a little bit more compassionate to what's going on. So I do enjoy working with families a lot. So I wanted to start first. I know everybody has some general sense of what's out there and how the government tries to help out. But I just wanted to give a little refresher because it doesn't ever hurt. And I learned yesterday when I was speaking next door that some people don't know of some of the benefits that are out there that seem so obvious, but maybe not to you. So I just wanted to mention them. SSI is a government benefit that's a stipend that is an income source for an individual who's over the age of 18 and it has a disability and is not likely going to be able to work in the workforce. And the reason why we say over the age of 18 is because up until the point somebody turns 18, their parents' assets and income count against the child. And so once they turn 18, that's not the issue anymore. And so they're entitled to that benefit. What you've heard, I'm sure, is that that benefit, it depends on the state that you're in. So that benefit is generally around 700 and change, but then states like, probably closer to 800, and then states like New York, where I am, they add a stipend to it to make it a little bit more robust. Not that much more robust, you're still under $900 a month. The threshold is you can't have assets over $2,000, so that's where I see a lot of clients, because I get those phone calls quite often saying either one, we didn't realize we had, my son or daughter has been getting gifts throughout the years. We put it in a bank account, and now they're in need of SSI, and they have money in their name that exceeds the $2,000. Or unfortunately, really in the last year, I've seen this scenario more often where a parent, it seems to be when parents are divorced, one parent knows all the rules and is doing all the work, and then the other parent doesn't pay attention to that. So I have a couple of clients right now whose one parent has passed, and now the child is inheriting an IRA or some types of funds that's gonna put them over the threshold, and we need to do a trust for them to help keep their eligibility. So SSI is very sensitive to the assets and income you hold. But I found out yesterday in the group that I was with, not a lot of people know about Social Security disability and the dependent adult child rules. So that is a scenario where a child might be getting SSI, and then at some point, one or both of the parents retire. And while the child doesn't have Social Security, didn't pay into the Social Security system, although in this conversation we're talking about how a child can work in the Social Security system. But I just wanted to mention again today that if they have not worked in the Social Security system enough to report on their own record, then they can collect Social Security benefits off of their parent. And it toggles back and forth between parents. So if one parent retires, they collect 50% of the parent's benefit. That doesn't mean the parent doesn't get the same amount. You know, they still maximize whatever they got, and then the child gets 50%. If the second parent retires and the 50% is more, the child can toggle to that parent. And on the first parent's passing, it's 3/4 of the parent's Social Security. And again, it can be a toggle back and forth. So as long as the child doesn't marry, they're entitled to that benefit for a lifetime. And that benefit also would include Medicare at some point. And I was surprised yesterday when people didn't know about that, so I just felt the need, even though this is education and employment, I felt the need to mention it again, because even in an employment situation, if your loved one doesn't work enough in the Social Security system, they still may be able to get that kind of benefit. So I didn't want to just leave that off. So I mentioned briefly that SSI is a financially means tested, which means you have to have less than $2,000. It also limits income. So in a case where somebody might be getting free room and board from their parents, if the parents don't charge anything for room and board, they automatically lose the a third of their SSI benefit. So parents, please charge your kids rent. I know it sounds odd, but they'll maximize their benefit. And then SSI also brings Medicaid with it. So because Medicaid uses SSI rules to determine eligibility, but SSI is more restrictive, you also qualify for Medicaid if you qualify for SSI. When it comes to working, a child can work and still get SSI. It's not a dollar for dollar breakdown in the benefit. There's a calculation that they do so that someone can work, get SSI and not lose all of their benefits, but still have Medicaid involved also, which is great in many instances for health insurance coverage. From an educational standpoint, a lot of what happens, and we have great panelists here who are going to give you their experiences, and I encourage you to listen and like relate to them. But what happens a lot of time is as children are going through school and education, at some point the conversation comes up about whether or not there is the possibility of going for higher education, or do we do more vocational education and training. So in some instances, children will use a path that's more of a vocational education, where in high school they're getting, middle school and high school, they're getting training that includes experience and direct study to a specific task, so that it's on-the-job training and they have the opportunity from high school to go right into the job market. Or you could do the traditional college route, which many people take that college route. And with the college route, different colleges will make modifications and accommodations based on an individual's need, whether it be someone comes into the classroom with them to take notes or assist with them, or there's just other extended time to take tests and stuff like that. Depending on what you're telling the school and what you need, they're able to make those modifications and accommodations. One of the questions that came up when we were having our panel discussion about what we were going to talk about today was 529 plans and the Eble account. So for those of you who are familiar, 529 plan is an opportunity for family members to set aside money tax-free in order to save for college. And so parents sometimes say, okay, but what happens if my child is not able to go to college and I set aside that money? Now you're going to take all that money back, pay tax. There are actually opportunities, if you need it and you feel like it's beneficial, to take those 529s and convert them to Eble accounts. An Eble account is established for someone who's disabled before the age of 26. Currently, it can be funded up to $16,000 a year. That number goes up incrementally over time. The reason why that number goes up is because the IRS has a value that they allow for people to gift away. So right now it's $16,000 per person per year. When that $16,000 accumulates interest in their calculation to go up another $1,000, that number will go up again. This year it just went up to $16,000 from $15,000 for a few years. That account can be funded up to $100,000 without affecting SSI benefits. If it goes over $100,000, that account is fine and will be spent down. SSI benefits will be suspended, but not, you will not lose the benefit. It just means everything gets put on hold, and then once the account comes below $100,000, benefits are reinstated rather than having to reapply. Why is this important and helpful to understand? Because you can only have one account per person. It can't be that an aunt opens up an account, a grandparent opens up an account, a parent opens, it's one account per disabled individual. And the biggest thing that people use the Eble accounts for, in an SSI scenario, I mentioned at the beginning that if you're not charging your child rent, then they lose their benefit by one third. In a traditional first party or third party supplemental needs trust, that also is what happens. But from an Eble account, you can pay rent, or if they're getting an apartment while they're at school, you can pay for those things out of an Eble account and not hinder their benefit at all. So it's very helpful, and a lot of people are starting to use this. When I spoke here in 2018, it was very new. Over the last 6 years or so, it has definitely expanded, and more states have them. There are some payback provisions to the government when the individual passes, but at the end of the day, most people aren't keeping money in there and letting it accumulate. But it is a great tool for letting a disabled individual have their independence because of the fact that it can accumulate up to $100,000 without affecting benefits. It gives them an opportunity to work, put money in there, accumulate things, and start to build their own independence. So it's a great opportunity. When we start talking about employment, just know I wasn't sure if you guys were getting the slides, so I put a lot of it. I don't usually put so much information in slides, but I put a lot of information in there so that if you do get a copy of the slides, it's there at your fingertips and you don't have to keep looking for it. From an employment perspective, an SSI recipient has an opportunity to use a program called PASS. The PASS program is a way of it's a plan to achieve a self-support, and it's an opportunity to essentially work a little, not affect your SSI benefit, and try to become independent and not need the government benefit. Because at the end of the day, we all want the independence, and we don't want to have to keep asking the government for help, because every time we ask them for help, they scrutinize what we're allowed to do. So the PASS program, what you have to do is you have to come up with a plan of what you're going to do, what your goal is, what items you need to reach that goal, what supplies you need. You find out how much the services are going to cost. You essentially have to go through a process with the PASS program that says, once you have all of those things in place, you have to go to Social Security to get them to approve the plan because they want to make sure it's an attainable goal. And the benefit to this, I told you SSI has a $2,000 asset threshold. The benefit to this is if you get a plan approved, then there's a means for you to set aside funds separate and apart from your $2,000 so that you could try and achieve that goal and have the resources to do it. And that's the idea behind the PASS program. From a Social Security disability standpoint, you have the Ticket to Work program, which is really a trial work period. So I have a lot of information here, not because I'm going to read it all to you, but because I just felt like if you got the slides, I wanted the information there. So Social Security Disability, understand that they have a threshold for gainful employment. So if there's an opportunity for somebody to work and make a certain amount, and this particular slide is showing 2021, but the 2022 number for an individual who is not blind, it's $1,350 a month. I don't know how New Yorkers are living on that because I can't imagine, that's like someone's rent. But if you make $1,350 a month, then that's considered gainful employment and you're not entitled to Social Security disability. And so what this program is doing for somebody on Social Security disability is, again, it has to be approved by Social Security, and it's an opportunity to try and get out in the workforce, and it gives you a time period that you can work. There's a 9-month threshold of testing things out, and then there's a 3-year time frame from being successful with that. There's a 3-year time frame that if for some reason what you thought was going to be a great opportunity and things were working out and you were working and doing well, if something happens and you can no longer work within that 3-year time period, you don't have to start from scratch on a Social Security disability application. You can pick up and reinstate your Social Security. So it's so very, very helpful to have these plans in place because the idea is to encourage individuals to be out there and working and have their independence and do whatever they need to do to be individuals. I mentioned at the beginning that I have a cousin who has epilepsy. She's actually my case study. She, at the age of 22, of course, right before, you know, it would have been better for her if it was right before she turned 22, but it was 6 months after she turned 22. She was actually helping her mother bake for a charity event that we were going to, and out of the clear blue started having grand mal seizures. Like, this kid has been through multiple brain surgeries. She has I think it's called a vasal stimulator. The amount of time and energy that goes into taking care of her. She has tried desperately to work. She was working for some time, and then she was working in a hospital transporting people, and then the hospital decided to do cuts and conveniently cut her in the middle of everything. She's done some retail, but she stays below the standard of the 1350 that she's allowed, because she's on so many narcotics that there are some days that she can't even keep her eyes open. She's just so tired and so knocked out by things that the PASS program or the Ticket to Work program doesn't work for her. She herself has enough credits in the Social Security system that she's collecting Social Security on her own record. She has Medicare, which is great. It supplements whatever her husband is doing as far as medical benefits. But I see her struggle every day, and I know that she wants to get into the workforce. And really, the idea of getting into the workforce isn't just to have economic and financial independence. It was socialization for her. It was an opportunity for her to get out and talk to people her own age, because really, when the pandemic hit and she lost her job again, because who was out there in retail, she was basically confined to the house, which she happens to live with my aunt. They have a mother-daughter, and that's her world. Her husband goes to work, her world is her mom. And she, when she started with these seizures, a lot of her friends of a long time, high school friends, they were there and with her for maybe 6 months, and then you weeded out the ones that are really good friends. So working is an opportunity for her to have some socialization, and she's still struggling to get back into that world, because every time they do another surgery or change her medications, it puts her in another state of, I got to figure out how to function in a day. So these programs are programs that give an opportunity for somebody to adjust with not only what's going on in their life, but to get out there, gain some financial independence, and have some socialization beyond just doctors and parents. So I encourage you. I know that I'm in New York, but I do have a network of individuals and attorneys throughout the nation. So if anybody has questions or needs somebody in their general area, because sometimes, like I said, with SSI, New York has a stipend, not every other state has a stipend. So it's always helpful to ask somebody in your state for resources. If anybody has questions and wants the name of somebody in their local area, just reach. You have my information in your handout from the conference. Just email me, reach out. I'm available. I could find somebody for you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So I will be talking about making that transition from high school to higher education, specifically the resources that you would want to seek out if you know that college is something that you're interested in or something that you know you want to do to further your career or further your interest. The first step would be, if you have an IEP, make sure that you know what the accommodations are for the IEP, whether that be extended time, having someone in the classroom with you, and making sure that you get a copy of your IEP. Most of the times, if your parent has it, make sure that you have that in hand when you go on college tours or college visits and say, hey, I'd like to request a meeting with the Student Services Office. Identify the Office of Disabilities, get in contact with them ahead of time. See if you can really get access to those individuals and make that connection early so that you have a person to say, hey, this is my point person. This is what I need. These are the accommodations I need for my classes. Here's what works for me, what doesn't work. And you can formulate a plan with that person that gives you everything that you need. The second thing is definitely making sure that you get letters sent out to your professors. Most colleges have a system for it where you put in each class that you're taking, and make sure that says, like, hey, this is what I need. I'm requesting accommodations for this class, and I need extended time on test, or I need to go to the student disabilities office to take exams, take it in an alternate location where I'm not exposed to any distractions or anything that could impair my ability to perform well. And also making sure that if you need housing accommodations, because there are schools that can do that, where if you are in a wheelchair, or you're mobility impaired, there are certain things that some schools do, most schools do have to provide, and that's reasonable accommodations for you. So if that's, say, the first floor of like your dorm, making sure that there's access to a ramp or an elevator if you need it, so that you can get around the campus successfully and make sure that it meets the ADA for that. Another thing that you'll need to know is, for financial purposes, there is the FAFSA. It's scary. It sounds scarier than it is, I promise. I just had to go through the whole process again for nursing school apps, so it's okay. They ask a lot of information. Most of the time, when you do it for the very first time, they'll ask for your parents' financial information. So that would be your tax information that you're from your parents, and they'll come up with a package for you that could include grants, it could include loans, it could include any form of financial aid that they offer. But you also have that option to do a scholarship, which I was very blessed to receive that. And that can cover some or all of your tuition. Sometimes it depends on a supplementary essay that you write. Sometimes it depends on your application as a whole. Making sure that, okay, I know I need help with this financially because college is expensive. We all know that. Higher education in general is expensive. Making sure that you can get the resources that you need financially, but also making sure that you know, hey, I do need these accommodations, whether it be a financial or in the education sense. But also knowing that making a connection with your professors, this is easier to do in small schools. Sometimes it's more difficult in a larger school setting to do that. But finding someone, and I was really lucky enough, I had Paul in college that basically helped get me through school. And he worked for the student services office. And he did my intake, which is what you generally, it's a form you fill out and you say, I have this, I have tuberous sclerosis, I need this accommodation, this is what I had in high school, this is what I'll need in college. And making sure that when you meet with that person, that you have a very good understanding and connection with that person. If you don't, it's okay to say, hey, I don't think this person's for me. I think I need to see what my other options are. So really kind of exposing yourself early and knowing what to do and have a plan in place can help make the process and the transition smoother, because the college transition is a huge one. I mean, especially if you're going, you live in one house your entire life, going to a whole new environment, that can be stressful. And having all these medical complications from TS on top of that can make it even more stressful. But making sure that you find a village early can definitely make the difference between having a successful transition, as successful as it can be, and struggling. Away.
Yeah, thank you, Celie. So, one thing I just want to say as a caveat, really building off of what Celie and Deanna shared, is that the employment realm, whether someone is coming straight from, college to the employment world, or if they're going to the employment world, after secondary school. There's a few different things to sort of think about from both a social integration standpoint and also from a legislative perspective. So, one thing I want to share at the outset is, building off of what you shared, Celie, is once you have you know, moved beyond secondary school. So whether you're 18 years old or you're just entering the employment realm as a full-time employee at that point, you know, you are no longer from an accommodation standpoint covered by IDEA, right? The Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, you know, which is covering IEPs. The new legislative protection is the Americans with Disabilities Act and the Rehabilitation Act. And, you know, what's really important to know about that distinction is you move from having that parental advocacy to being your primary advocate. And you know, that call out is something that I think takes a lot of adjustment for folks to make. And I can speak, you know, personally to that. You know, I remember, you know, even you know, the process of you know, engaging in internships over the summer. You know, once I was in, you know, a university setting, and it can feel really intimidating to adjust to the working world, particularly when, you know, we especially folks in the TS community rely on that support system. And so it is an adjustment that folks have to consider, and knowing what your rights are under the ADA and under the Rehabilitation Act are really critical to make sure that you can set yourself up for success. You know, what's tricky about this conversation in particular is that when we talk about, you know, these pieces of legislation, you know, the only way you can take advantage of them as an individual is by disclosing, you know, your disability status. And, you know, for many folks, myself included, you know, this is something that we have to grapple with, you know, at times on a daily basis. You know, who do we share this information with? Why do we share this information? And I just want to say at the outset, you know, when you decide to disclose, it's a very personal decision. You know, there is no sort of one answer that fits for every single person. But I can just speak to my personal circumstance and that of a lot of folks who I've worked with. I think, you know, being able to disclose it only makes you perform. You know, in a way where you're able to really take advantage of an environment that's structured for you. And, you know, when you disclose your disability status for accommodations, for example, you know, you are legally protected as soon as you have that conversation. And, you know, it's something that, you know, HR offices, recruiters, right, you know, they understand this legislative environment very well. And I just want to sort of say at the outset that the way that our legislative framing is set up and the way that job applications are set up is that, you know, if someone needs a reasonable accommodation, which I'll get into in a second, that, you know, the question really becomes, you know, can you perform the essential functions of a job with or without reasonable accommodation? So there is no need for you, especially early on in an employment process, to answer that question of, well, yes, but I would need XYZ. You know, the answer is yes, because you can perform those functions with or without a reasonable accommodation. Getting into what those specifics are something that, you know, we'll explore in a second. So, you know, building off of what I just shared about reasonable accommodations, so, you know, I often felt that, and I felt this in university settings as well, to your point, Celie, that requesting accommodations would be a burden for either the university or for the employer. And I wanted to just share this statistic with all of you. So, 56% of workplace accommodations for employees cost absolutely nothing to execute. So, right, the majority have no economic burden on the employer whatsoever. If there is any sort of economic burden, it's $500. Right, so this is minimal in the grand scheme of things. So you shouldn't feel any sense of guilt or trepidation, you know, in asking for this. It's something that is important. It's a human right, And it's also something that doesn't break the bank. So, you know, the other call out I want to make here is that, you know, when you get to an employment situation, right, sometimes you're requesting reasonable accommodations for an application. Sometimes you are requesting them once you're already on the job. Sometimes it's both. You know, this can be a consistent process. It can be a fluid process. And, you know, I've heard some of our speakers share this, you know, over the course of the days that we've had here. But, you know, someone can acquire a disability or they may need a reasonable accommodation at any point in their life. And just because you may not need one when you start doesn't mean that having one while you're employed, you know, won't be beneficial. So, The other call out I want to make, and this is something that's meant a great deal to me personally, is employee resource groups. So just curious with a show of hands, how many folks here have heard of employee resource groups? Okay, so a few folks. So you know, these are typically found in larger organizations, so larger nonprofits and for, you know, certainly large for-profit companies. I have personally found employee resource groups are a great avenue to pursue, you know, especially for folks who have TSC or any other disability. We've heard a lot in recent years about diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives, you know, not just from a public policy level, but we've heard about it in corporate America. We've heard about it in our local communities. And you know, employers are listening. And so with these employee resource groups, you know, you have the opportunity to network with, you know, folks who might be at the same level of you in an organization, whether you're early in career, or if you're at a more senior point in your career, you know, you have the opportunity to work with experienced folks and also executives at an organization. And many companies have employee resource groups that are specifically focused on disability-related issues. And that's something I think a lot of folks don't necessarily think about. And it's a great way to find community. It's a great way to network and really to find folks who you can ask questions to that you might necessarily feel comfortable asking your manager at the outset. You know, for myself, I work at a Fortune 5 company, and I had joined an employee resource group focused on disability issues. And you know, I currently lead that employee resource group. I'm the national lead for that group. We have, you know, 1,700 employees across the country who belong to that employee resource group. And they consist of folks who work in a retail environment and who work in a corporate environment. So we have part-time employees, we have full-time employees, we have executives who are members. And it's really been just an incredible resource for me personally in building confidence and finding mentors and peers who you can really tap into and you know, set, I think, a really great trajectory for the rest of your career. Another thing that I think is really important about those employee resource groups is at most organizations, there's an executive sponsor. And in some situations, there's two executive sponsors. And executive sponsors are folks who are usually at, you know, at an executive leadership team level, you know, what we might colloquially call the C-suite. And these are folks who understand that folks who have TSC, who have other conditions, that they're bringing diversity to an organization, and that retention of those folks is critical, not just from, you know, oh, this feels good type of perspective, but that this actually drives a business model forward. And, it, you know, you're bringing talented folks to the table. And we have perspectives as folks in the TSC community about a range of different things, whether it's healthcare, it's you know, public policy, because we've had to live it. And so I would encourage you to view that as a strength. It's certainly not a liability. So I think that's an important call out. And if anyone wants to chat about that or has questions, definitely happy to speak more about that, you know, later in this conversation. One other call out I'd like to share is For folks in the disability community, there are professional organizations and leadership programs that are specifically tailored to you. And so for folks in the TSC community, I would say, you know, if you're interested in apprenticeships, internships, if you'd like to think about different careers, you know, whether it's in corporate America or in some other avenue, you know, these are really important organizations. I'll get into, you know, what some of those are on the next slide, but, you know, these are in many situations free of charge. You don't necessarily need to fill out an application, and it's a great way to have webinars and network with folks, and, you know, I have found those to be very personally enriching. So, you know, some resources that I wanted to call out, you know, so for more information on reasonable accommodations, there's a fact sheet that I've put in here. The Job Accommodation Network can be a really great place to start when you think about that reasonable accommodations conversation. There are so many different accommodations out there, and you know, the list that I provided in that link, it's illustrative, not exhaustive. So it lists some frequent reasonable accommodations that folks have pursued, but it by no means encompasses everything out there. One other thing, so Lyme Connect and Disability Inn, which I put here, these are those professional organizations that are free of charge. And for anyone out here who has TSC, or you know, for folks who also might be a member of the disability community, this is a great organization. And so whether you are at a senior point in your career or you're beginning your career, they have, you know, networking sessions, professional development workshops. They actually have scholarships at $10,000 that you can apply for each year throughout your undergraduate or graduate career. You know, if that's something that's of interest, definitely check that organization out. Disability Inn is another one. It's really focused on young professionals and also folks who are interested in providing mentorships or being a mentee. You can sign up for that organization. They have a specific program for an early in career pipeline, and they also have you know, opportunities for folks who might be employers and interested in potentially branching out into the disability hiring space. And if you don't have the ability to join an employee resource group, I always encourage people, start one. You know, this is something that companies are thrilled to have. They want to have more employee resource groups. They want employees to start them. And all it usually takes is a few coworkers or a few new friends that you might meet at work. And it's a great way to build bonds and to show that you're an innovator and that you want to drive the conversation forward and create a more inclusive work environment. So, you know, there's a lot of opportunities out there and a lot of things that you can all take advantage of. And if you want more information, definitely happy to share anything else as we move forward. So thank you. And with that, I'll pass it over to Kirk.
Thank you, Jonathan. So I'm going to be discussing networking and building connections, what that might look like as you navigate your life in post-secondary education or employment opportunities. So what I first wanted to start off with is, Jonathan kind of mentioned this a little bit, is after you move past post-secondary, you're going to be transitioning into more of a self-advocate, right, as opposed to having more parental or loved one advocacy group. So just to kind of start off, I think it's important to discuss why. You know, why is this important? Becoming a self-advocate. It helps with better communication skills, right? Whether that be from a medical perspective at a doctor's appointment or when it comes to your educational pursuits, right? So advocating for yourself in terms of what accommodations you might need and also in an employment setting as well. It also helps with your networking, which is something that we're going to be discussing here in a little bit. It helps with your career growth. And it can also help in your personal life as well, right? Becoming a better self-advocate. What you got to do first is believe in yourself. I know it sounds kind of tough at times, but truly, you know, when you believe in yourself, that is kind of the foundation that's laid in becoming a self-advocate, right? Know that you can do it. Know that you have all the skills necessary to achieve the goals that you want. Another important facet to remember is to know your needs and wants. This is super important. It sounds kind of straightforward, but knowing your needs and wants are truly what is going to drive your decisions that you make in life in terms of what you pursue educationally, what you pursue professionally. And it's also going to take charge in what you prioritize in your life. Okay. Another aspect to remember is to know your rights. Jonathan mentioned the ADA and the Rehabilitation Act. Know that you are provided equity under law. So if there's ever any doubt with that, know that you are backed by the law. And then the last thing is to just prepare and plan, right? Taking into action everything that you've built up to that point in order to get to where you want to be. So the next thing we're going to be discussing is finding your interests, okay? And the first thing I want to say is it is okay to not know right away. As you leave post-secondary, you're going to be a teenager who expects you to know what you want to do with your life. On average, according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, the average person is going to work about 12 different jobs, right? I am 24 years old. I've already changed jobs 3 times since I've graduated college. It is okay, right? That's what life is about. So the next question that comes up is what exactly can you do, right, in order to find your interest, find what you want to do in life? The first thing is just explore, okay? Don't be afraid to pursue different aspects of your life that you enjoy. Even if it's something that you may not know, you can pursue professionally or educationally. Pursue it. You never know what might come up. Another opportunity is through education, right? Education might look different for everybody in terms of what they want to do professionally. Know that there are multiple options that you have, okay, in terms of what to pursue and the accommodations that you might have. And then the last thing that we can do is pursue internships or other, I consider them low-cost, high-benefit opportunities. And I say this because internships or job shadowings or apprenticeships, they're, in terms of time, not necessarily super long, right? Some could last a few months, some could last a year. But it's in that time that you truly experience real life examples in the field that you're pursuing, right? So, but you're not committed to it per se. And then the last thing is to think long term, okay? When thinking about your interests, sometimes you might have so many that it's going to feel difficult to narrow it down in terms of what you think you might want to do. So sometimes you can actually work backwards with that. What are things that you value? Is it personal time with your loved ones? Is it being outside? Is it being challenged in your work pursuits? Like what do you value as an individual? Okay, and then what are your needs and wants? Again, reiterating this, what do you feel like you need out of a career? What do you feel like you want out of a career? What kind of life do you want it to provide you? Okay, and then the last thing we're going to be discussing is how to build your resume, also known as a CV, and networking. Okay, so first off, what exactly is a resume? I teach this in high school. Best answer I like to give is it is just you, right? It is, depending on your profession that you're pursuing, it's typically a one page piece of paper. Where you list your name and your contact information, but it also lists your accomplishments, your background, your interests, and your skills. Right? So it's a way for you to showcase everything that you've built up to this point in your life. Another common question that I get, and I experienced this too right out of college, is how do you build a resume? Oftentimes you see these entry-level jobs, and it says like 4 or 5 years of experience required. I don't know if any of you have experienced that. I know I did. That's not true, okay? I'm just gonna go ahead and say that. If you read a little bit farther, there's an or section, which says a combination of education or prior work experience, right? So employers understand that as an entry-level position or an intern, you're not probably not going to have an extensive amount of work experience. So use that to your advantage, right? Pursue different projects in your educational pursuits. Intern, job shadow, list different projects that you might have completed during your educational pursuits, and volunteer. Those are all examples of experience, quote unquote, that a lot of these employers count as work experience when you look at job postings. Next thing we're going to be talking about is networking, what exactly it is and why it's important. Networking, all it is just meeting new people and making connections with them. That's all it is. Why it's important, according to Forbes, roughly 70 to 80% of all jobs are actually filled primarily through networking. That's a pretty drastic number. If you think about it too, when you network, I have this picture up here in the blue, when you connect with somebody, you're not only just connecting with that one individual, but you're actually connecting with, maybe indirectly, but you actually are connecting with everybody that that person knows as well. Right? So if you've met somebody here at the conference, you've already made a connection, and indirectly you are connected through through their network as well. It's that whole 6 degrees of separation idea. And the last thing is, how exactly can we build our network? We live in a digital age now, and social media is one aspect that people are pursuing a lot to actually build their network. Jonathan mentioned a few resources that existed. Disability Inn is a great one. I happen to use it myself. It's a great source for you to link up with other individuals potentially with disabilities and companies who are having diversity and inclusion initiatives that directly link you to those organizations. LinkedIn is another resource that is purely organized for networking. It is like a professional Facebook, if you will, where companies can post jobs. There can be updates on the companies. You can connect with people. And another cool thing about LinkedIn is the way that you build your profile is essentially what your resume is going to look like, just from a digital standpoint. And then the last thing is just through people, right? If you have difficulty connecting, try to find people with similar interests. At least, you know, like at the end of the day, there's one thing that you might have in common. Because again, that power of networking extends way farther beyond this, just that one person, right? So thank you. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Preston, who's going to be talking about living independently.
Hello, everyone. I'm here to talk about living independently in through college and campus life and apartments. So transitioning to independent living, there's many different topics to consider when living on your own. Each phase is different as you get older. The bottom line is don't do too much too fast. Take it one step at a time. It's an adjustment, so don't be afraid to ask for help along the way. And learning different life skills before you move out can help, especially main things such as laundry and money management, cooking and cleaning, and et cetera. For campus living, it's meant most of the time it's the first time away from parents for a very long time. So it's okay to be scared. If it's possible, try to room with a friend, so it makes it much smoother. But rooming with people that you don't know is also a good idea, so you can learn how to meet new people. Learn how to tell your roommates your conditions so they know what to do if anything goes wrong, and also to let your RA know at the same time. So epilepsy, they have an action plan. Set boundaries is very important because we each all have our own things, and going through each other's stuff is always not a good idea. And finally, go to events and dorms or join clubs because it's much more fun once you get to know people, and especially once you start spending time with people that have the same interests and hobbies as you. And then once you graduate, you usually go to apartment for the first time. When looking for apartments, do your research, look through websites like apartments.com and Craigslist to help find listings. Look for ones that are close to places you'll be going to frequently, such as work, school, or grocery store. For instance, I'm not able to drive, so I have one right next to the public transportation system in Dallas called DART, and I can take that from point A to point B each day. Ask people what they think of the area so you can have different opinions before you make your final decision. And most importantly, make sure you can afford rent before signing a lease. And to go along with money management, set a budget, try your best to spend on money on things that you only need, not only on things that you want. And set reminders for paying rent, just so in case you forget, since our lives get much busier this time of in this stage. From here, I'll pass it on to Emily.
All right, I don't know how I'm following up everybody else. Everybody else is like really amazing. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about building a support network. So like I mentioned, I don't have TSC myself. My sister does, and she is dependent, so we aren't looking so much at higher education, more just at maintaining her well-being, figuring out what the best course of action is going to be for her. So for us especially, we are looking more at like what's going to be our situation in the future. A lot of things with her is like day-by-day sort of stuff. Like she just had a NeuroPace implanted, so we didn't expect that like 2 months ago, but here we are. So it's really up in the air of what's going to be going down in 5, 10, 15 years from now. But there are a lot of options still. So like once my parents get older, what's going to be going on with her? Is she going to be living with me? Is she going to be going into a fam hab? And there's a lot of really great resources for things like that, especially for those who are dependent. But going into higher education, I did talk to everybody else here because, again, I don't have a whole lot of experience with it, and we aren't really looking into it super seriously for Caitlin. But like what everybody else mentioned, CSER action plans are really important. We have them for Caitlin for high school because she has fairly severe epilepsy. You know, making sure your family is supportive, making sure your friends are supportive. And if you're a family or a friend of someone who has TSC, just supporting them through everything, asking them if they need help with anything, just trying to support them through everything that's changing in their lives like that. Because like we've established, it is a really major change to go through, even if you don't have TSC. But going into job force, there are still job options for people who are dependent. And there are a lot of high schools that have like job training opportunities, like the one that Caitlin goes to, sort of. COVID kind of put a bit of a dent in that plan there. But it has basically field trips where they go out and they go to stores and they just kind of adapt to visiting busier places, which can be really difficult. You know, Caitlin is fairly sensitive to different noises. Like if something's beeping at checkout, then that might set her off and she doesn't want to go back to that store for a long time. So those types of exposures are really nice for her. And that is really one of our number one things for her is trying to get her exposed to that so that we can consider having her go into a workforce of some type. But like I said, it's kind of playing by ear with everything with her. But yeah, these guys are amazing. Like, I just wanted to point that out. These guys are seriously amazing. yeah. They have a lot of stuff that they can tell you about living with TSC and building a support network for someone who is going to go into higher education. So if you guys have questions about it, I really encourage you guys to ask them. If you have questions about living with someone who's dependent or being a sibling, I am very willing to answer anything you guys have, or like if it's completely unrelated, I will still answer it. I don't have an opposition. We guys know Penelope Clearwater here. But with that, we will open it up to questions.
Yeah, I just want to say, you know, thank you all so much for you know, engaging us, and I have to say, you know, building off of what you just shared, Emily, this is an incredible group of peers and folks in our community, and it's been an honor and privilege to be a part of this larger family, and you know, just so grateful for everything that you all shared. So thank you for that. Okay, great. So I think there's some questions already. So please go ahead.
I both have a question and have some information to share for maybe some other people that hasn't come up in the course of this group panel discussion. So I have a daughter who's 20, graduated from high school 2 years ago, and in most states, but we live in Illinois, there is a program called Vocational Rehabilitation Services. And you don't have to be disabled to get services through that program. They can provide skills evaluation and testing and also job coaching. So we used that program and it was fantastic because my daughter just needs a little extra like on-the-job training to be successful, but it's difficult when they're over 18. I mean, she needed somebody to help advocate and be a liaison between herself and her employer to find out, you know, how am I doing? Are there extra training I could use in this or that situation? And in Illinois, if the testing indicated that she could accomplish like an associate's program, one option was to go to a community college and they'd actually help pay some of the tuition through the program. If we did that, then she wasn't eligible for the job coaching, so we decided to do the job coach. But and then there's a waiting period of, I think it's a year, before you, if you change jobs, they can be involved again. So that's just a really interesting resource that hasn't come up that might be valuable for a lot of other students too. And then the other thing is there were some transition services between high school and college, even if she went to like a community college, that were available through the school district. And my daughter went to a private school, and we didn't have a guidance counselor, which was too bad. But then when I found out about these services and contacted the public school system, was actually informed that if she had accepted a diploma, she became ineligible. And they can do something where they hold back her diploma. It's not that she didn't earn it, they just don't grant it right away. And then she could have been put into this kind of transition program for a year that helped her get through community college, and there were little training groups and things like that. But once she accepted her diploma, she was no longer eligible. So that would be something to talk to the people at the school districts before you accept your final diploma. And then the third thing, I had a question regarding job applications and disclosing disabilities. Do you legally have to disclose a disability when you're applying, or can you wait until you have an offer before disclosing that? Because I know that the American for Disabilities Act says that they can't discriminate, but you get to small employers and they can look through a pile of 20 applications, and the ones that are checked, oh, I have a disability, they may just say, oh, I've got other applicants that don't have that, I'm not even going to interview this person. So what are the legal, when do you have to legally disclose that, or do you ever have to legally disclose a disability?
Yeah, maybe I can take the last one, and then Deanna, sure. I could pass it to you for the other two. So, you know, you don't ever have to legally disclose your disability status or, okay. you know, or right, the challenge with the ADA is that if you want to receive, you know, reasonable accommodations, right. You know, the only way you can take advantage of that is by disclosing. Okay. So there's sort of that, right, that component to it. The thing is, right, like with disabilities, and obviously TS is a multi-system condition, okay. right? It's everyone is distinct. I'll share this anecdotally in case this provides some context. So, for example, like I may need to get shoulder surgery, I do not have a reasonable accommodation that would give me access at this point in time to like text-to-type software or dictation software, mm-hmm. But that would be something that I would then contact at my employer, which has it set up this way. It's a large employer, right? They have an HR department. There's actually a reasonable accommodations team, mm-hmm. and so I would reach out to them, commence the process, have a conversation with my manager. I wouldn't need to have the conversation with my manager, but I would choose to. Mm-hmm. And so, but to your point, at a smaller organization, right? I think this is sort of a nuanced conversation, right? Does the law protect you in every situation? Yes. Is it possible that someone could potentially act in a way where they are discriminatory or where they are not treating someone the way they should? Yeah, it's a reality, but. I would say that I think many folks, employers, large and small, understand that a disability situation and an accommodation situation is fluid. It's not necessarily right from the day that you are on the job. And some folks, it takes time to feel comfortable, right? For certain individuals, they may need an accommodation just to engage in the application process. But for other folks, right, you know, maybe they just need an accommodation on the job, and that conversation happens once they've been given an offer of employment. So okay. It really depends, but I would say from my experience, the amount of employers that I've seen, large and small, who've been accepting and accommodating have dwarfed anyone who's been, having issues or not receptive to the fact that, you know, this is an essential component, not only for them legally with the Department of Labor and state and local laws as well as federal, but also just from, you know, the perspective of what's best. So I don't know, Deanna, okay. if you wanted to cover.
Yeah. No, I agree with Jonathan, and I think unless the job specifically has laid out the guidelines of what's required and you truly can't meet the requirements of what's required without disclosing that there's a disability that needs accommodations, okay. I think you don't have to say anything up front. I think it's one of those things that you can go and disclose what you need to disclose because it's a personal thing.
Okay.
There's privacy laws that protect you also.
Okay, thank you.
So far I've had two jobs. Like, I worked at retail and now I'm at a front desk, and I have trouble staying at a job because my anxiety's so bad, and I've taken so many medications, I've done therapy, and it's like just nothing seems to work. Do you have any advice on like how to stay at a job and like function, because I have a hard time like functioning at a basic job?
Yeah, and I'll add one thing in, and if any of the panelists want to take this too, I'll pass it to them. But you know, what I would say is, you know, one area that we're seeing increasing focus on, right? Mental health is part of the inclusion conversation, and it's part of a disability conversation where we've had all these workshops and discussions on TAND, and it's a real thing. If accommodations would be helpful, right, when talking to a provider, whether it's a mental health provider or another one of your providers, if there is something that would make it easier to for you to just perform, you know, the essential aspects of your job, I think it's worth a conversation with your provider and potentially with your HR office for your job, just to see what might be possible to set you up for success. I know that many organizations are having a lot of conversations on mental health and realizing it's part of that disability conversation. So I think that that could be something that that you know is worth exploring. Any of the panelists have any other thoughts or recommendations?
Can I just, from a personal standpoint, is part of the anxiety the sitting and like sitting there for so, you know, long stretches? Like if you asked your employer for an opportunity to get up and step away from the desk and like take a 10-minute walk, would that help with the anxiety of sitting there?
No, not really, because the desk job that I have right now, it's pretty relaxed and stuff, so it's like, why do I have anxiety over nothing? Because it's like an easy job, and like I already kind of have breaks and stuff, and like that doesn't help.
So it might be a conversation with the employer just to see how, what can happen in the, like what it is about the job itself that's giving you that anxiety, so that as a team you guys can work together, so that they're aware of the situation and they're not so quick to just let you go because things aren't getting done.
Okay, also I wanted to say all of you did great. I loved it, so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. A while back I remember the TSC had partnered up with some type of hiring firm or like a talent acquisition firm. Does that ring a bell? That would help with job seeking?
I don't know. Anne, do you know anything about that?
I'm the staff member in the room. Unfortunately, I'm only 7 months on staff, so I'm not positive, but I'm happy to take that question back and I can give you my card after and we can certainly talk more about that. And I know that there are also some specific organizations. The one that comes to mind right now is Chronically Capable, that support kind of young adults specifically who are looking to understand or find flexible work situations that might work with them. So we can, happy to talk more later and do some research on what we might have done in the past, but just not positive off the top of my head, sorry.
And a second thing. My understanding is if you are a government entity and you receive public funds, aren't you required to hire people with disabilities?
So I'll say a little bit about this and then maybe Deanna, you can kick it off too. So yes, I mean, employers that are federal contractors have, you know, EEO affirmative action requirements, and that applies to disability. One thing I'll share just off the bat, there's a utilization goal, which means it's aspirational, it's not required, that those contractors are, they should be looking for within certain job categories and within their entire workforce, 7% of the employees in those areas should be people with disabilities at minimum. We know that there is a lot of work to be done, but that is something that the Department of Labor has you know talked about as part of the OFCCP, the Federal Contract Compliance Programs. It's something that is, you know, for the EEO affirmative action piece and non-discrimination, absolutely. But there is actually that affirmative push to try to get to that 7% number within job categories and the entire employment sector. So I think that's a very positive thing within the last few years. Deanna, anything else to share?
No, I think that was well said.
Thank you.
Hi, I just want to say all of y'all have been very inspiring. This has been probably one of the best sessions that I've gone to. So thank you for doing this. So this might be more for Kirk. Lime Connect, is that like another form of LinkedIn, like disability and LinkedIn, and then Lime Connect? Or is that more for just networking instead of looking for jobs on there and things like that?
Yeah, Lime Connect has both of those capabilities.
Okay, yeah. Neat. So that's awesome. And then the other thing is, I feel like with the onset of COVID, remote work is obviously very prevalent. Through any of these networks, and this can come from anyone, have y'all seen any success with through Disability In or Lyme Connect or even through LinkedIn, finding any remote work through there. We come from a very, very small town in South Florida, so sometimes looking for remote work is, you know, the best possibility for gaining more experience.
Yeah, I can speak on it, and then I don't know if you want to touch up a little bit too, but yeah, there has been a drastic increase in remote opportunities, just the way that you can blame it on COVID, technology, just easier access, but there has been a steady increase in remote opportunities, and oftentimes they'll disclose that in the job posting. It'll say, you know, remote work or remote available, things of that nature. So yeah, definitely. And I have a few friends that have been successful with obtaining remote job opportunities, so yeah.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Yeah. Hi, I just, one, you're all remarkable. Thank you so much, this was so helpful. But two, I wanted to share some information with parents here or other individuals who are thinking about college. Our daughter's 16. We're in a very gray area, right? She, public school wasn't for her. We put her in a private school in second grade. We're not sure. I'm afraid, you know, will she go to college? I'm not sure. You never want to set your child up for failure, but you also don't want to doubt them, right? So we're not sure, but the private school that she goes to is for kids who learn differently. And I learned that there are actually a lot of colleges around the country that are, they promote themselves for individuals who have individual learning needs. So I'm actually going to share that list with the TS Alliance. And I just thought it would be helpful for all of you to know it, and that it's not as expensive as you would think. I was actually surprised when I saw the tuition that included, you know, accommodation. So I just wanted to share that information, and thank you for sharing your stories with us.
Yeah, thank you so much. Really, really appreciate that. All right. Are any questions coming in, Anne?
So we don't have any questions from the live stream at this point, but while I've been talking, I see a Daniel approaching the Q&A mic, so. Okay.
Hey, Daniel.
Two questions, though. First question, I know a lot of people do go to school. Does the laws and regulations apply if you do, study abroad for your accommodations? And then also, how does one, so like myself, if I do a move to another country, or someone like that wants to either move to another country and still have those advocate accommodations for work or higher education, I should say, within that country to, I know that a lot of countries in the world, there's some are or more four, and some are non-four people with disabilities.
Yeah, that's a great question. For the first question, I don't know, Kirk, you have anything to share? I know you studied abroad.
So for the first question, kind of more oriented towards the study abroad, great question, by the way. I think it really depends on your program exactly and where you're going. But with that, I would recommend partnering as much as you can with whatever school that you're at ahead of time and researching that before you go. And that might be something that you utilize to say, okay, where would be the viable options for me to attend or for me to go? So I'm not too well versed in terms of how other countries, you know, might, how your accommodations might translate over there. I know in my experience, I worked ahead of time with my school, and I was in part of a program that was in theory like an American university overseas. So the transition with my accommodations was a little bit more streamlined than I think it could have been potentially with applying separately to an international school. But that's something that I would probably start ahead of time with your current university or your school.
Before the second question, Preston, did you have anything to add on to that one?
No, actually, I was thinking the same thing that Kurt was saying, that you know, certainly if you're going abroad with an employer or with a school, you're covered by the rules here. But if you're just doing it on your own and jumping into another country and working in that other country, I would think you're subject to their rules. So I don't know that you have the same backing to get those accommodations, because it's going to depend on them.
Yeah, and you know, something to build off of that point too, right? It really depends on the country. So if it's a developed country, you can probably expect, you know, similar laws to what you would see in the United States in terms of disability non-discrimination. Many countries that are less developed countries, sometimes they tend to quantify disability in percentage terms, sort of like the military does, and so there's specific formulas and things get a little bit more granular there. So I've had friends who have done programs through host universities, not through a United States university, and it can become more complicated. But yeah, for the U.S. based institutions that sponsor a program, definitely, you know, same you know, ADA coverage.
I can speak a little bit on working internationally. I don't know if this paints a little bit more of a clear picture or not, but I did work while I was in Germany. I interned at a brewery. It was a great experience, you know. But because I was over there on a student visa, they were not legally allowed to pay me. So I wasn't getting any stipend or anything. I mean, they were paying me in, you know, they're paying me in cases, and then, you know, I would go to the supermarket and for their recycling program, that's kind of how I would get paid, quote unquote. So I know, at least from that perspective, I can speak on the fact that things are different in terms of what your situation might be. So I don't know if that clears it up or anything, but.
Excellent. I know you've gone abroad a lot, Preston. Anything else to share there?
I really only did it for vacations. I know my sister went abroad for law school, but she would really have to say what she did that. How she did that. Got I it. Don't know many details.
All right, there you go. So if we need good travel tips, we know where to go too. okay, yes. Oh, a question or? No, okay. Yeah, right. Maybe. Anything else? Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you all so much, and you know, we're happy to chat afterward as well. So really appreciate it. And if any folks are watching virtually, you know, you can feel free to reach out to us as well through the staff at the TSC Alliance. So I want to thank these incredible panelists for just being amazing people and for sharing such great perspectives, and thank you just for everyone asking, you know, really great questions. So enjoy the rest of the conference, and thanks again.